Welcome to Remote Worship with Johns Creek United Methodist Church. My name is Reverend Brittany Sanders, and I serve as the youth and college pastor here at the church. We are delighted that you have chosen to worship with us this day. I encourage you to find the button where you can register your attendance so that we can know that you are worshiping with us. Now let us join in our opening hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. I invite you to join me in our confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and our soul and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us amend what we are, and direct us what we shall be. so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That is proof of God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Now let us affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed as our statement of faith this day. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we enter into our time of prayer, I want to remind you that you can submit your prayer request online, or you can get in touch with someone at the church, because we want to continue to be in prayer for our church family, for our neighbors, for our friends. I also want to remind you of our Stephen ministry. It's a program in which you can be partnered with someone to accompany you during a season of life in which you might need someone along the journey with you. If you feel that you may be in need or know someone who may be in need or might like to have someone walking alongside them in this time, I encourage you to reach out as well so we can keep you connected with our Stephen ministry team. Let us pray. Loving God, as we come into this time of prayer, we pause. For we know it has been a week of awaiting news. For we know it has been a week of ups and downs, of emotions, of joys, of sorrows. As we join in prayer this day, we lift the joys and concerns that have been listed and named before you and those that lay on our hearts and minds. We pray for our church, for our community, for our state, for our nation and our world. We pray for the members of our armed forces and military as our nation pauses this week to honor and remember those who fought, fight, and serve and protect as Veterans Day approaches. We pray for our police officers, firefighters, and first responders. We pray for our medical teams, mental health professionals, and those seeking to create a vaccine for the virus. Lord, we seek your presence in these days as fires continue to arise, storms continue to bring destruction, and the pandemic continues to spread. We seek your presence, for we know there is much unrest and uncertainty among us. We seek for your will to be done, for your kingdom to be brought about through the work you do in and through us in the world. May we not only acknowledge but accept your call to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you. May your light shine in and through us to expose the places of darkness and brokenness that await the light that is you, the hope that is found in you, the wholeness and restoration that come from you. We seek these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, as we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. During this time of offering, I want to remind you that our stewardship campaign is underway, and we are so thankful and appreciative of the pledges that have come in thus far. If you haven't turned in a pledge yet, I encourage you to continue to prayerfully consider how you might be able to support Johns Creek United Methodist and to enter your estimate of giving online or mail your card to the church. We do give thanks for the ways in which our church has continued to be the church during these days. We give thanks for the continued support that comes in through your gifts of tithes and offerings. I want to remind you that you can mail a check to the church, you can give online, or you can put a check in the mailbox outside the church offices. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for the many gifts that you have given to us. We return a portion of those gifts now through our tithes and our offerings. May they be used for your honor and your glory as we continue to be the church in ministry with and for you here and beyond. Amen.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. We are so glad that you've joined us for remote worship here at Johns Creek United Methodist Church. Thank you so much for being a part of this service. We do thank you. I know it's a special time for you and maybe your family and loved ones as you connect with us and worship together. Before I go into my scripture and prayer, I would like to thank those of you who have pledged for our 2021 financial year and this year's stewardship campaign. We appreciate it. We want to have a vibrant and fulfilling and effective year next year of ministry, and we can't do it without you, so we appreciate it. Those of you who have yet to pledge, we appreciate you doing that as soon as you can. I do have an update. Right now, we have 131 pledges totaling around 1,020,000. And so that is tremendous. That's something to celebrate, but we're still not there yet in terms of our goal. So once again, we appreciate you turning in your pledge as soon as you can. And we thank those of you who already have. I want to read a passage of scripture to you that comes from the first chapter of the Gospel of Mark, verses 14 through 15. Now, after John was arrested, speaking of John the Baptist, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Let us pray. Lord, we do thank you for this time of worship. And Lord, I do thank you for the gift of preaching your gospel. It is a sacred task that I cannot do on my own strength. So Lord, speak to me and through me in such a way that all of us do receive a word from you that will make a difference to our lives. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. The older I get, the more I realize one of the most profound questions ever written appeared on my report card growing up. Uses time wisely? Now, I didn't always score very well on that particular category, but the older I get, the more I see the profound importance of that question. So let me ask you, do you use time wisely? How do you spend your time? Now, this morning or this afternoon or whenever you're listening or watching me, I'm not talking about time management or organizing your time, as important as that is. No, today I'm talking about time well spent. I'm talking about living your life on Kairos time, not Chronos time. Maybe you're saying, "Well, Charlie, what are you talking about?" Well, in the New Testament Greek, there are two words for time. There is Kairos time, and there is Chronos time. Now, many of us are familiar with Chronos time. Chronos time is empty time, drudgery time. It's the ticking of the clock. Picture a prisoner checking off each day on a calendar, waiting to get out. Picture someone in the office who can't stand their job, waiting for 5 o'clock. Picture someone who can't sleep and they just watch the clock all night long. Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock. It's like the next minute, the next second is the same as the last. The student waiting for the bell to ring, waiting, waiting. It is drudgery. Whenever we talk about killing time or passing time or doing time, we're talking about Chronos time. But then there is another time that's described in the Bible, and that is called Kairos time. And that is completely different. That is the opportune time. That is full time. That is vital time. That is decisive time. That is critical time. That is significant time. It is God's time. When the light bulb turns on for you, when you gain a new perspective, when everything falls into place, that is Kairos time. It's those moments where 5 hours have passed and it feels like 10 minutes. Ever experienced that time? Some theologians call up revelation, a time of revelation when God speaks clearly to you and you sense it and you hear it, or a time of inspiration. Kairos is a key word in the New Testament. In fact, in the text I just read to you earlier, when Jesus comes preaching and he says, the time is fulfilled, the word he uses for time is kairos time. And Jesus's ministry was packed with kairos time, with vital time, with full time. So I ask you, are you living your life on kairos time or chronos time? Now, in Thornton Wilder's play, famous play, Our Town, there is a character named Emily who unfortunately dies young, but she's permitted to relive one day of her life with her family. And so she chooses to go back on the day of her 12th birthday. But when she returns home for her 12th birthday, that particular day, she's very disappointed because she notices that her family is too busy, too preoccupied to see her or to see others. Her whole family, her mother, her father, her sisters, her brothers are completely busy with life. And she pleads with them to look at her and to look at life and to appreciate life, but they don't listen. They're living on chronos time. And finally, there's a moment when in a profound way, Emily cries out these words. Do any human beings ever realize life while they live it? How about you? Do you actually realize life as you live it, or are you just passing the time by? Are you living on kairos time or chronos time? Billy Graham talked about kairos time in a profound way when he was once asked the question by a critic, Dr. Graham, you preach to millions of people, but how do you know when you're preaching that you're actually preaching the very word of God and not your opinion or your thoughts? And Graham replied quickly, oh, that's easy. It's when at least one person who's listening to me no longer hears my voice, but hears the other voice speaking. That's kairos time. Those moments in your life when the voice and the message and a sense of God breaks through and everything comes together, there is revelation, there is light bulbs, that is kairos time. And maybe you're asking, well, Charlie, how do I live more in kairos time and not chronos time? Well, today I'm going to give you some examples of those kairos moments that I've experienced and I've seen other people experience. And I'd like to say as an aside that I appreciate the thoughts of William Barclay and James Moore as I prepared this message that has profoundly affected me. When it comes to thinking about kairos time versus chronos time, there are those kairos moments of gratitude. Now, when I was in high school, we had a foreign exchange student named Johan who lived with us for several months. He was from Finland, and he came from very modest means. And so when he came to visit us, he was overwhelmed by all the blessings and all the things we had in America. In fact, he thought we lived in a mansion. We didn't. We just had an average suburban house that had 4 bedrooms, was nothing spectacular. But compared to the house he lived in, he called it a mansion. He would often say, Charlie, when are we going back to your mansion? One day we went to the grocery store and we were shopping around. All of a sudden, I lost Johan. I couldn't find him. And I'm walking all over the grocery store trying to find where he is. I couldn't find him, going through every aisle. And finally, I saw Johan in the cereal aisle. And he was just staring at all the cereal. It looked like he was looking at the Grand Canyon, just looking at all the cereal in the cereal aisle. I said, Johan, what are you doing? He said, Charlie, I can't believe all the cereal you have in America. Back in Finland, we just have 2 or 3 different cereals. But oh my gosh. I said, you're right, Johan. But when we finally got back into the car and I drove home, I had a kairos moment of gratitude, realizing all that I truly had. I heard a wonderful old story about a farmer who lived on this same old farm for all his life. And one day he decided, I just want to move. I want a change of scenery. I want something different. And so he called a real estate agent and he listed his farm. And the agent came out to look over the property so the agent could prepare a newspaper ad. And after the agent prepared the ad, he read it back to the farmer, and it read this way. Beautiful farmhouse, ideal location, excellent barn, good pasture, fertile soil, up-to-date equipment, well-bred stock, near town, near church, near school, good neighbors. Wait a minute, said the farmer. Read that again. And so he said again, beautiful farmhouse, ideal location, excellent barn, et cetera, et cetera. Farmer said, change my mind. I'm not selling. I've been looking for a place like that my entire life. Wow, can't we relate to that? Sometimes we get so focused on the negative. We magnify our difficulties and challenges so much that we forget the acres of diamonds that are all around us. We forget all the blessings we truly have. And I know it's easy right now to complain about life, to complain about COVID, to complain about the election, no matter where you stand on that. It's easy to do that. But I tell you, sometimes we need a Kairos moment of gratitude where we stop and take a moment to look at all the good things we have. In fact, I challenge you to do that. Before you go to sleep tonight, write down 5 things that you're grateful for and experience a Kairos moment of gratitude. Well, if we're going to live on Kairos moments more often than Chronos time or Chronos moments, we can have a Kairos moment of gratitude. But there is another Kairos moment I want to lift up for you today that I've experienced before, and maybe some of you have, and that is a Kairos moment of conviction. Oh, folks, this is the moment that jars your conscience. These are the moments where you realize that you need a Savior. These are the moments where your spirit convicts you so much that you need to make a wrong right or do the right thing in the midst of challenges in your life. That is a Kairos moment of conviction. I'm thinking of King David in the Old Testament. After he sinned with Bathsheba and had Bathsheba's husband killed, Nathan came to visit King David and told him a parable about a farmer who had many herds, but he killed one poor man's lamb. And David responded to the story, well, that man ought to be killed. And Nathan replied, you, O king, are the man. For David, it was a Kairos moment of conviction, and he repented. I think of Alfred Nobel, the famous chemist who created dynamite. Something interesting happened to him in his life, though, when his brother died. The newspaper got confused, and instead of putting his brother's obituary in the newspaper, instead the newspaper put Nobel's obituary in the newspaper. And when Nobel opened up the paper, he read his own obituary, and he felt convicted. Because the obituary talked about him creating dynamite, a substance made for war that caused great pain and great death and great anguish. And he was so convicted at that moment that Alfred Nobel set up a foundation that created the award as we know as the Nobel Peace Prize. A Kairos moment of conviction. Oh, I recall experiencing a Kairos moment of conviction a few years back when I was serving in Florida. I was playing golf one day with my buddies, and there was a group ahead of us that was so slow. You golfers can appreciate that. People who play so slow, they hit one or two balls at a time, and they get you out of your rhythm. Oh, it was just so frustrating. They were so slow. And finally, we got to a hole where if you walked off the green, you were right next to the next tee box. And as we walked off the green, there the slow group was still teeing off. And there was a bathroom between the green and the next tee box. Well, I said, I'm tired of this. I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. And I proceeded to walk to the foursome ahead of us, that slow foursome, and talk to them about it. And when I got even with the bathroom, a member of the foursome looked up at me and said, hey, are you Pastor Charlie that serves that church up the street? I said, yes, I am. He said, oh my gosh, my wife is not going to believe I ran into you. We watch you in your service every week. Oh my gosh, we love it. And he said, I have to be honest with you. My wife is struggling with cancer, and I've been struggling with depression, and there have been weeks when your service has saved us, has gotten us through the week. He said, listen, let me take a selfie of us, and my wife won't believe I ran into you on the golf course. And he took the selfie. He said, anyway, did you need something you were walking towards us? I said, no. I was going to use the restroom. And the rest of that round of golf, I prayed to God, Lord, forgive me for my impatience. Lord, give me more understanding. Lord, give me more love. Forgive me, Lord. It was a Kairos moment of conviction. But there are other Kairos moments. There are also Kairos moments of pure love. These are the moments where a love that you share with another person in that moment is so profound that everything passes away. Nothing else is more important. And I experienced one the other day. In fact, earlier this week, Paul went back to preschool here at Johns Creek for the first time since February on this past Wednesday. And it was a very busy morning. I had a list of things to do at the church a mile long. We needed to get Paul ready. He was kind of getting nervous about going back to school. Brandy had lots to do. We were just running around. I had to do a Facebook Live prayer and get that done and then move on to the next thing and get my list and get Paul ready. In the midst of all of that, I hear Paul cry out from his room, Daddy, Daddy. I said, what, Paul? Come here. I said, Paul, listen, this is a busy morning. Dad, come here. And so I walked to his room, and there was Paul laying on his little bed with a book in his hand and his blanket. He said, Daddy, come lay with me and read me this story. I said, Paul, I don't have time. You got to get ready for school, and I got to get ready to go over to the church. I have lots to do. Daddy, please. And knowing he was nervous about school, I said, okay, just one quick story. And so I walked over to his little bed. I mean, it's a small bed. If you saw it, you'd say, you really fit in that with Paul? But I did. He said, I'll make room for you. And I laid down with him. I picked up the book. He snuggled next to me, and I read the story. And when I finished reading, he said, Daddy, I love you. And at that Kairos moment, nothing else mattered. My to-do list didn't matter. Getting my sermon finished didn't matter. Getting Paul to school on time didn't matter. All that mattered was my love for my son and his love for me in that moment on that bed. A Kairos moment of pure love. You know, Jesus' life and ministry was filled with these moments. Can you imagine? Every person he touched, every person he healed, every person he talked to with compassion, at that moment, all that mattered to Jesus was that person. Seeing Zacchaeus in the midst of a large crowd, hearing the cry of blind Bartimaeus, feeling the touch of a sick woman at the hem of his garment. Jesus' life was filled with Kairos moments of pure love. So how long has it been in your life as you've been living on Chronos time, numb to the world? How long has it been since you experienced a Kairos moment of pure love? Well, there's another Kairos moment I want to lift up. There's another one that I've experienced, and perhaps some of you have. And that is a Kairos moment of inspiration. It's that moment when you're moved to action. When something inside of you by the Spirit convicts you to act, you must act. You're so moved spiritually and moved emotionally. I think of Moses in the burning bush. When Moses experienced the presence of God, and God said to Moses, "Moses, I want you to go and set my people free." And Moses went. Why? Because it was a Kairos moment of inspiration. When was the last time you had one of those moments where you were so compelled that you had to respond, that there was something inside of you that moved you, where God spoke to you and you said, "I will go." God called you and you said, "I will go." When was the last time? You know, there's a truth that God is still calling people right now. In fact, He calls people all the time. Every day, God is calling people. Calling people to do what is right, calling people to do what is just, calling people to love, calling people to take advantage of life, calling people to take advantage of an opportunity. And some will respond, but you know, some won't. Some are living so much in Chronos time, they're so numb to their life that God can never reach their heart. You know, there's an old legend that often haunts me, of a group of travelers who are traveling the desert on camel, and they came across an oasis with a sign. And the sign read, "Pick up pebbles and put them in your pocket, and tomorrow you will be both glad and sad." And so they did what the sign said. They picked up some pebbles and they put them in their pockets. The next day, they remembered that sign, and they were amazed when they took those pebbles out of their pockets and those pebbles had turned into gold. But they were also sad because they didn't pick up more. You know, sometimes I think that the end of our life is going to be like that. We'll think of all those moments, those opportunities that we embraced from God, those Kairos moments that we picked up, that were just gold. And then at the end of our life, we're going to think, "Gosh, I wish I had picked up more." It's Kairos moments of inspiration. You know, Leo Bascalja, I've mentioned before, he was a professor in Southern California, and he often gave this assignment to his students, a paper, where he asked them to answer this question. If you only had 5 more days to live, what would you do and with whom? And of course, in the papers, he would receive a variety of answers from his students. Some said, "I would go to the beach and I would watch a sunrise." Some said, "I would spend it with the people I love." Some said, I would tell people I love that I love them and I would share with them what I thought about them, how I feel about them. Some said they would find that person that they wronged, that they feel guilty about, and say, "I'm sorry." And when those students got those papers back after they'd been graded, in every single paper, Bascalja would write this question: "Why don't you do those things now? How about you? What if you had just 5 more days to live? What would you do? How would you use your time? Would you operate on Chronos time in those moments or Kairos time?" One time when assigning that same assignment to his class, Bascalja received in a paper a poem written by a student that was so profound, he wanted to share it. It was about putting off and putting off and putting off those things that are so important, especially with regard to people. And so Bascalja asked the student if he could share it, and she said, "Sure, but I want to remain anonymous." The poem is entitled, "Things You Didn't Do." "Remember the day I borrowed your brand new car and I dented it? I thought you'd kill me, but you didn't. And remember the time I dragged you to the beach and you said it would rain and it did? I thought you'd say, I told you so, but you didn't. Do you remember the time I flirted with all the guys to make you jealous and you were? I thought you'd leave me, but you didn't. Do you remember the time I spilled apple pie all over your car rug? I thought you'd yell at me, but you didn't. And remember the time I forgot to tell you that the party was formal and you showed up in jeans? I thought you'd drop me, but you didn't. Yes, there were lots of things you didn't do, but you put up with me and you loved me and you protected me. There were lots of things I wanted to make up to you when you returned from the hospital, but you didn't. The point? Do it now. Live on Kairos time as often as you can, not Chronos time. Use your time wisely. Let's pray. Lord, penetrate our cynical and numbed lives more often. Help us to see you and how you operate. Help us to prioritize. Help us to love more often. Help us to live by your example more often. Help us, Lord, not to miss this life that you have created for us. Help us, Lord, to use the time you've given us wisely. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Receive this benediction. And now may that mind that was in Christ Jesus be in you also. May the love of God, our Heavenly Father, abide with you this day and through this week. May the guidance and power of the Holy Spirit fall fresh upon you, and the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ go with you and sustain you both now and forevermore. Amen.